You wouldn't mind turning, please, to 2 Peter this morning, first chapter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 through to verse 12. We're going to look this morning at a precious portion of Scripture, an incredibly rich passage of Scripture that I trust will be a blessing to our souls, and that God would give me the grace and help this morning to be able to preach it. It's one of those messages this morning that we cannot just hear and then say, well, the job is done, but it's one of those passages that keep coming back, you know, that we're always to gauge where we are in our Christian journey by these very things that we're going to bring out this morning from this passage. And so 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity, love. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them, and be established in the present truth. Amen. And so, Father, this morning, Lord, we prepare our hearts. We thank you, Lord, that we can have an open Bible this morning in our hands. And Lord, that we can have open hearts to go with it, Lord. We pray, Father, that you would speak to us. We pray this morning, Lord, that the word of God would trouble our souls this morning. That the word of God would get deep, Lord, under our skin, as it were, and provoke us, Father. Like a little splinter going into our finger, provoking us, Lord, until we get it out. So, Lord God, we pray this morning that our lives would be conformed in greater glory and power to those very things that we have just read and that we should learn further of now this morning. We do ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The title of this morning's sermon is, If These Things Be In You and Abound. If these things be in you and abound. Now, as I stand here this morning before you with an open Bible, there's an old idiom that springs to mind. You will have heard of it before, I'm sure, and it goes like this. Settled on your lease. Settled on your lease. Now, for those of you who know your Bibles well enough, you will know from whence, from what place, this saying arises. I had to look it up myself. I knew it was scriptural, but exactly where I couldn't pinpoint. It comes up twice in Holy Scripture, once in Jeremiah chapter 48 and verse 11. We'll look at that in a moment. And again in Zechariah chapter 1 and verse 12. In Jeremiah chapter 48 and verse 11, we read these words. Moab hath been at ease from his youth, and he hath settled on his lease, and hath not been emptied from vessel to vessel, neither hath he gone into captivity, therefore his taste remained in him, and his scent is not changed. Jeremiah chapter 48 and verse 11. Now this at first sight seems to be a strange verse, and perhaps we are struggling even now to fully grasp and understand the sentiments of the heart of God speaking through the prophet Jeremiah. Moab hath been at ease from his youth, and he hath settled on his lease. Now, Moab, as you are most likely aware, was a neighboring cousin nation to the Israelites. Remember, the Moabites descended from Lot, nephew to Abraham. And they were a nation that dwelt as neighbors alongside Israel, but they were a nation that were hostile towards Israel. And when the northern kingdom was carried away captive at the hand of Shalmaneser, king of Assyria, around the year 722, I believe, BC, the Moabite nation was spared. And here they now are dwelling at ease without fear of war. And the phrase that Jeremiah uses to describe this state of ease is settled on his lease. He hath settled on his lease. Now, in the fermenting of wine, that process whereby the juice of the grapevine is turned into alcohol, the pressed juice of the grape was poured into a bottle or into a vessel, the grape skins and all, and it was left for nature to take its work. And as the chemical breakdown took place, all the impurities would settle at the bottom of the bottle as a sort of thick residue. This residue is called lees, L-E-E-S. Some of your translations might say dregs. It's the same thing, the residue, the lees, the deposit that settles at the bottom of the bottle after the fermenting process has begun. And the longer that that wine was left to sit in his lees would be the stronger the flavor of the wine. Now, when it came to preparing that wine for drinking or perhaps for storage, the lees would need to be removed. No one would like to drink some wine and have a mouthful of sick goo in our mouths. And so the residue, the lees, would be removed. And how this was done, it would be done by the wine being poured from bottle to bottle. And each time the wine was transferred bottles, a little more of the sediment would be left behind until that wine would be purged of its lees. Now, what's God saying here in the text? Moab had been settled for too long on his lees. He'd been left too long sitting in a place of comfort and ease, undisturbed, where by contrast the other nations surrounding him, in particular Israel, the northern kingdom, had been taken off into captivity. It's an idiom, a saying, a maxim. Now, the result of this was that that nation had become strong in flavor. Pride had settled in arrogance. They'd become haughty in their own estimation. And all of this was about to change now as God was going to visit the Moabite nations in judgment, in judgment. And there's a lesson for this for each one of us, that when you and I are left too long in a place, in a state of undisturbedness, we too can settle on our lees. God was raising up the Babylonian nation, that fierce nation that was coming from the north, and he was about to address the arrogance and the pride of the Moabite nations, the nation of Judah included. When we get comfortable, then with that comfort can often set into our hearts a sense of pride and a sense of arrogance. And what you and I need from time to time, it's just human nature. We need a good shake-up. Now, I know we don't like to be shaken up, but God says it's the only way. Because when you and I are left for too long in a place where we're just settled and comfortable and we're never challenged, then what can happen is we can settle on our lees, we can get comfortable, and we can become proud. And so God would pour us from vessel, as it were, to vessel in order to purify us and get us ready for use. Well, with God's help this morning, that's exactly what I want to do. I want you to note in the text that we've read this morning in 2 Peter chapter 1, that Peter begins by reminding the believers there of their positional standing in Christ, who they are in Christ. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith, that we have come into the truth, into the true faith. We've obtained this in the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. To them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things, this is our positional standing, if you like. This is our inheritance. This is what we've come in to possess, whether we fully grasp it or not. Peter's saying here that according to God's divine power, he has given to you, he hath given to me, all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge. Epignosis, the word in Greek there, it means to the full knowledge, and I'll come to that shortly. It isn't merely a head knowledge, a cerebral knowledge, but something that we've come in to possess and experience in the very depth of our being in salvation. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called you unto glory and virtue. excellence, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now, as you read the letters of Paul, Peter's not alone in doing this type of thing, where he presents doctrinal truths. He makes statements that positionally are ours. Whether we know them to be so in experience is one thing. But Paul here, Peter in this case, is telling us where we stand truly in the sight of Almighty God and what has been given freely to us by His grace. The Apostle Paul does it in so many of his epistles. He begins with doctrine, and then he moves from doctrine, from teaching, to application. Now, what's this telling us? It's telling us this, that doctrine matters. What you and I believe concerning Jesus Christ is of tremendous importance. Tremendous importance. Foundations matter. You try and convince a building firm that the foundations don't matter, just get building the wall. They'll say you don't know what you're talking about. Foundations matter. Everyone wants to build, but if there's no foundations upon which to build, then guess what? The building's not going to stand. It can look $1 million, to borrow an American idiom, but it will come down like a pack of cards at the slightest disturbance. And so we must always, as Christians, begin with foundational matters, and that's why Paul begins so often in his letters, whether it's the book of Colossians or Philippians, you know, these kinds of epistles. Paul begins with the great positional truths of Scripture, because these are anchors to our soul. Who we are in Christ, what we are in Christ, where we stand in Christ. But there's a word of caution that I want to give this morning, that we cannot stop there. We can't merely rest on positional statements and say, well, amen, praise the Lord. It is always the heart of God that these truths be worked out in our experience. We must be poured into the vessel of experience. And what I find generally today is that so many Christians have remained for too long settled on their lees, living in the realm of positional truths and positional statements, but never ever coming down into the land of experience. And I'm sad to say this, but I see it everywhere. People can talk a lot of things and tell you a lot of things, but it seems that they can't show you a lot of things with their lives. And I want to say that there's something wrong with that picture. And preaching generally up and down this land has become a lost vocation. Within the remnant church, we have many teachers that for many decades have taught line upon line and precept upon precept. And I thank God for all of this. But the job of the preacher is not necessarily to do that. The job of the preacher is to stir and to provoke and to challenge and to disturb. And what we need so desperately in this present day is preaching that would move God's people from the realm of the academia to the realm of the experimental, the experience. The problem that I've witnessed within generally the remnant church, and I say I don't truly like that phrase, but I mean those that are striving for truth, those that are longing to walk the narrow path, I find generally that they have been fed to the hilltop, but the problem is they've not been exercised. They've not had the sharp point of the sword of God's word pressed against the bosom. They've not felt the heat of Holy Ghost conviction, bringing the truths of God to bear against their conscience. And the result of that is that we have fat, overfed sheep with knowledge pouring out of their nostrils, but their lives there really, in a sense, lives not there to back it up. And I want to say this morning that a head full of knowledge with a heart full of sin is not the objective of God. I'm seated with Christ in heavenly places. Praise God, brother. But meanwhile, here on planet Earth, they're seated in Satan's seat, enjoying the filth of the world. But I'm seated in heavenly places in Christ. See, the two don't marry. I'm more than a conqueror through him that loved me. Good and well in theory, but in practice, how is it that at every trial they meet, they are conquered? But I'm more than a conqueror through him that loved me. Or how about this one from Romans 6? I'm crucified with Christ. And we can say it like almost like a mantra. And we can say, praise the Lord. But then if that's the case, why is it that the flesh has the mastery over them every waking moment of their lives? Now, what am I saying this morning? I'm saying this, that the great positional statements of truth found within the Word of God have to be worked out in our lives. And that there should be an experience on display, a life on display that marries with the profession that we make. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new facts. Now live it out. And let's see that at work in the lives of the people of God. We see a church today, at the best part is all knowledge. But I ask the question this morning, where's the power? Where's the power? When I look at the stated truths in Holy Scripture and I see them waning in my own life, I want to say this morning that it bothers me. It bothers me. It bothers me. I can't settle on my lees for very long. And I thank God he doesn't allow me to. Because when he sees me in a place of compromise and a place of undisturbedness, he takes the cutting edge of his word and he presses it against my conscience. And he allows me to peer at the positional statements of the truth of Scripture. And I hear his voice say, but where is it in your life? And that's challenging. And we ought always to be challenged like this. It's time for the rubber to meet the road. It is time. Now, I'll give you an example in Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1. I'll give you a flavor of what I'm trying to articulate and get across this morning. And then we're going to go over to 2 Peter. Must we have doctrine? Yes. But we can never have doctrine at the expense of experience. The two must always marry together and join. In Colossians 3 and verse 1, if ye then be risen with Christ, if, that's a positional truth that we have risen with Christ, then Paul says, allow that reality to work itself out in your life. Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. That if you claim to have risen with Christ, then there ought to be an outworking of that reality in your life. And so Paul is saying, if I've risen with Christ, then seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Why? Because you're dead. The reality of the matter is that we have died with Christ, have been buried with him. Our life is now hid with Christ in God. And we have been raised to newness of life in him. And Paul says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. And if that be so, then Paul says there ought to be something done about it. Put to death, therefore, your members. Mortify your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affections, evil concupiscence, speaking of here of sexual lust, covetousness, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. And so this is a little example, if you like, of where Paul says positional truth ought to marry with experience. So let us go back to 2 Peter now, and I want to look through the first 3-4 verses, and then we're going to turn to bring the application. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us, through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus, our Lord. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Grace and peace be multiplied to you. It's a form of Christian greeting. Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, our Lord, according as his divine power. Now, what Peter here is doing is he's taking the tremendous truths of who we are in Christ and what God has wrought in our hearts, and he's trying to set it before the people. We say today, I'm a Christian, okay, but what does that really mean? That if we could peel back the veil, as it were, and look at the mystery of what has been wrought within us, the new creation, then friends, we'd be in awe and wonder. We say Christian, meaning what? Well, Peter here is attempting to break down, and he's saying that God Almighty, that as we have come into this knowledge, this epignosis, as God has brought to our hearts the understanding and the revelation of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, that God, according to his divine power, think about that for a moment, the very God who called into existence the universe, let there be light, and there was light. This divine power of Almighty God. Paul says that by this, or Peter says that by this power, God has given to you and he has given to me every single thing under the sun that we should ever need to live the Christian life. Oh, friends, He's given unto us all things, not some things, all things that pertain to life and godliness. That glorious treasure store has been deposited within your soul in the new birth. And it came about through the knowledge of Him that has called us to glory and virtue. True knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ isn't being able to recite scriptures. The true knowledge of God has been brought internally into our hearts by the ministry of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, that we have the very mind of Christ. That the Spirit of God, Paul talks about this treasure being in earthen vessels in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And we who were blind and dead in our trespasses and sins have been quickened to newness of life and have had the scales removed from our eyes so that we can now behold the Savior. The lights came on. That's what Peter here is saying. But he doesn't stop there in verse 4. He says, whereby are given unto us, by what? The divine power of Almighty God. The knowledge of Him that has called us unto glory and virtue. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. Promises that have been given to you and I. That by these very promises, we might be made partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I like how one translation puts it, the New Living Translation. It's a freer translation. I want to read what it says concerning verse 4. And by that same mighty power, He has given us all of His rich and wonderful promises. He has promised that you will escape the decadence all around you caused by evil desires, and that you will share in His divine nature. You see, there's promises that God has given to you and He has given to me. He's equipped us with everything we should ever need to live this Christian life. And when we fail to exhibit the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, we can never blame God and say, well, Lord, you've left me deficient. God says He's given to us everything that we need and promises abounding. That we can experience this new life, not only in our heads, but in the application of our lives. That is, that the person bound his whole life by drugs with an encounter with the risen Savior can be set free and can be brought into a glorious, victorious life through a divine power that's given to him in God's. We're claiming that we have life, that we've been made partakers of the very nature of God. What does that mean? Not that we're God, but that we've partake, or we've partook, we're sharers in that God Himself has come to indwell these vessels of clay, such that it can be said of us that our bodies are a temple of the Holy Spirit, God indwelling man. That's a bold statement. Exceeding great and precious promises have been given us. Now, promises as I understand them are for the taking. Promises aren't like museum artifacts, where we just peer through the glass and we look at them and we read the notice which says, look but don't touch. God doesn't give us promises so that we can be spectators. He gives us promises so that we can inherit them and experience them. And this is really what Peter here is going to go on to say. He says, and beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge. In other words, having whet their appetite and Peter disclosing to the believers this glorious inheritance, the promises that are theirs in Christ Jesus, having whet their appetites, he lifts his voice and cries aloud, "It's yours for the taking." And friends, I could never preach a message like this to a room full of unregenerate sinners because I'm asking them to do something that they cannot do. I'm asking them to do something that is impossible for them to do. But to the child of God who claims that God himself by his Spirit has come into their vessel and has made them a new creature in Christ Jesus, then Peter says the things that he's about to reveal to them are theirs for the taking. Beside this, giving all diligence. The New Living Translation says here, so make every effort to apply the benefits of these promises to your life. I'll say that again. In light of what Peter has just set forth before the brethren, make every effort to apply the benefits of these promises to your life. The King James uses the word diligence, giving all diligence. Beside this, giving all diligence. Now that word diligence is an intense word, and personally I would define diligence as this: focused effort fueled by zeal. Focused effort fueled by zeal. Diligence. In the Greek it means earnest zeal. It's not an haphazard approach to it. Well, you know, if I get around to it. No, diligence speaks of intensified effort. It speaks of focus on steroids, if you like. That I must have this. It's the man who has lost his car keys and with diligence he searches the house because he's got an appointment in 20 minutes and if he doesn't find them, he's going to be late. He doesn't walk around the house just with his hands in the pocket. There's an intensity about his search, diligence. And so Peter here says, beside this, giving all diligence, making every possible effort in light of our standing before the Lord and the promises that we have inherited in Christ. Make every effort to add to your faith virtue. Now, the thing that I am greatly disturbed about is that sometimes I fear in my own life that I'm falling short of the blessings that God would have for my soul. That if you like, I'm driving around in a Ford Fiesta when there's a Bentley parked in the garage. Friends, we've Bentleys parked in the garage. And I'm not talking about physical prosperity. I'm talking spiritual prosperity. That if we truly understood the power that has been given us in Christ Jesus, we would not make excuse for half of the things we do. Beside this, not just having the promises, but making every effort to bring alongside them, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. And to virtue, knowledge. and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, to patience godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, to brotherly kindness charity. Faith is what we began this Christian journey with, that firm conviction based upon God's word, that firm persuasion which moved us to action, namely that we put our confidence in the Lord. There's no other way that we can receive of God's blessings and of life everlasting than that we receive it by faith. We were broken vessels, sin-filled vessels, blackened, darkened vessels. And God says, you're either going to receive the blessing that I have in eternal life, you're going to accept it freely and receive it at my hand, or you're not going to have it at all. And we came through faith by the grace of God to obtain this glorious life that Peter here is trying to describe. We received it all by faith because we came to the Lord and took him at his word and said, Lord, I believe. And the Lord granted to us all things through his divine power that pertain to life and godliness, and gave to us exceeding great and precious promises. And as you follow Paul Peter's reasoning here, he begins with that base, as you were, of faith. And what he's saying is that we should add to that faith other qualities. That is, that our faith should not be left alone, but we should add to that faith virtue. We'll look at these in a moment. And to virtue, knowledge. And to knowledge, temperance. To temperance, patience. To patience, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. And then he comes to the capstone, at which there's nothing further to add. Love. And he drops the capstone on love. And so there's no denying here that Peter has in mind this ascending journey, if you like, in qualities being added to our lives as Christians, qualities that we should strive for, qualities that aren't just going to come down out of heaven, because what God has already done is given to us, and therefore it's for us to be diligent to live out the very things that have been deposited in our hearts. You know, some Christians are waiting for a thunderbolt from heaven before they'll start to love. If you're a child of God, then God has taught you how to love. And it's disobedience on our part why we're not walking in the way in which the Spirit of God is leading. And so he begins with faith. And then he adds to that virtue. Now, this word virtue means excellence. Excellence. We should strive for excellence. We should be diligent to ensure that we add to our profession of faith excellence. But more specifically, it means moral excellence. Moral excellence. Now, if you look at that word virtue, it also means valor or manliness, courage. Now, what relationship does courage, manliness have with moral excellence? Well, it has quite a lot to do with it, because standing firm in what is true is never easy, and swimming against the grain takes courage. It's not a wimp's religion to be a Christian. It takes tremendous courage to say no to the flesh. It takes tremendous courage to stand against the grain in your workplace, where all your friends around you are immoral, and you're going to say no, and you're going to play the man, and you're going to be courageous and say, I'm not going with the crowd. I'm standing firm in what Christ has required of me. So virtue speaks of courage, but it speaks of moral excellence. Doing what is right against the grain. And then Peter says, add to this, add to virtue, knowledge. The word knowledge there is gnosis. Peter doesn't denigrate knowledge. Knowledge is important. Feeding on the word of God is important. And so Peter therefore does say that as well as having faith and moral excellence, we should ensure that we add to this knowledge. A good understanding of the word of God is absolutely vital as God would have us to live out this Christian life. Ignorance, my friends, will never do when God has given a Bible in your hands and he commends to each one of us his word, and we should be diligent to be students of it. And by understanding and growing in his word, we will grow in our knowledge and experience as well. He moves from knowledge then to temperance. Temperance, add to knowledge, temperance. Temperance speaks of self-control, self-control. That is, as a Christian, we can never say, well, the devil made me do it. No, the devil can't make us do anything. He can tempt us, but he can't make you do anything. And nor can the flesh make you do anything. We can be tempted by the flesh, but the flesh can never make us do it. Why? Because we're responsible for our actions if we're children of God. And one of the fruit of the Spirit is temperance, self-control. I like how one commentator puts it. He says, holding the passions and desires in hand. I love that. Being a master of your passions and desires. That is, that your desires and passions are not going to rule you because you've got control over them and you're going to rule over them. Will we be tempted? Yes. Tempted within, tempted without. But Peter here says, add to knowledge self-control. Self-control. He then moves from self-control, temperance. And he says that we should add to temperance, patience. Patience is that quality of endurance. It speaks really of perseverance, even when abiding under tremendous trial, that we learn what it is to anchor in, to hold on to God, and to ride through the storm. And that does something to us. It generates tremendous perseverance. That we can say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And it's no longer just a profession. But we've got testimonies in our life of actually doing that. Trusting God through difficulties. And riding through the storms. Peter says we should be active and diligent to pursue that. Then he says to add to patience, godliness. Now, godliness is a beautiful word because it's really a fusion of two different concepts. It really speaks about piety. It's not a word that we hear today very often, piety, P-I-E-T-Y. Godliness speaks of piety. What's piety? It's a combination of fear, godly reverence, and love. It's really fear of God and love for God being fused together to give us godliness. It's a beautiful thing, because if I fear God, then I will obey God. I fear God, I have a reverence for God, and I fear him to such degree that I'm going to obey him. But lest I go too far the other way and drop off the cliff edge, love compels me to serve him and to adore him and to love him because he's my God. Godliness. A brother or sister that is godly is a man or a sister or a woman that loves God and fears God. And where those two things are fused together into one, we say that it's piety. That person is godliness. And Peter says we're to add to patience godliness. Then to godliness, brotherly kindness. The Greek word for brotherly kindness here is the word philadelphia. Philo meaning love and adelphia meaning brother. It's a filial love. It's a love that you have towards the brethren. And we're getting closer now to the bone, if you like, that in the church of Jesus Christ, there ought to be philadelphia. That my heart ought to be moved towards you with a love that previously I did not have before I knew the Lord. John tells us that we can know we've passed from death to life because we love the brethren. And one of the great foremost proofs of a person being saved is that they love the brethren. Philadelphia, brotherly affection. And then he drops the capstone on top, charity. Agape in the Greek. Now, where Philadelphia brotherly love speaks about a love towards one another, Christian toward Christian, agape love speaks about love unconditionally. That is, that not only do I love the brethren, but I love the world, even my enemies, even those that would persecute me and speak all manner of evil against me. Agape love compels me to love them and to have compassion on them. Agape love cries out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now, I say again that there's no denying the progression in Peter's thinking, that there's an upward trend in the qualities that he lists, one thing being added upon another. But I want to say that we do have to exercise caution here. In verse 5, we're met with this word, add, and as we read through the succeeding verses, or the verses that precede, we see that it's inferred. In verse 5, beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance. The inference is the word add there is present in each, one thing being added upon another, but we're told explicitly of this in verse 5. Add to your faith virtue. Until we come to love. Now, we need to be careful because Peter is not thinking linearly here, linearly, I can't even say the word. He's not thinking in a linear fashion. And what I mean by that is not seeming to suggest that, well, okay, in year one as a Christian, you had faith, and you have faith in year one, then in year two comes, and now you've got virtue, moral excellence. And then year three comes, and you add to that now knowledge. And then year four comes, and then you add to that, you know, patience or temperance. Until finally you come all the way to year eight, and you finally have love. And so in other words, in year one, two, three, four, five, six, you didn't have any love until you got 8 years down the road. That's not what Peter's thinking. As you look at this word add, where he says add to your faith virtue, it actually means in the Greek to furnish alongside. So to bring alongside these qualities, other qualities, not in a linear fashion. In other words, over time we add each one. But the word actually means to introduce simultaneously. And so as a Christian, these qualities are always present in our life. You can't evidence you're a Christian unless you have love. So love must be present at birth. At birth, the new birth. And the proof of this is verse 8. Look, for if these things be in you and abound. And so Peter's saying for us to do a bit of inspection here. And he's saying, if these qualities that I have just mentioned, these eight qualities, are in you, but not only in you, but abounding in you, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Not if one or two, three be found in you. If these things, what things? The things he's just listed. If these things be in you and abounding. One commentator said, if they are in you in rich abundance, then what? They make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So you understand now that knowledge is not mere head knowledge. Epignosis is not mere recitation. I can talk all day about what virtue means and what brotherly kindness means. I can preach a sermon on charity, love, agape. But Peter says, see to it that these qualities belong to you in experience. That these things are not only in you, but that they are overflowing in your life. And what's that going to do? Peter says it's going to ensure that you're not barren. The Greek there means idle, unresponsive, as it were. Still, settled on one's lees. They make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, I don't want to be unfruitful in my life, in the knowledge of my Lord Jesus Christ. I want to ask you a question this morning. Are these qualities in you? And do these qualities abound? Bound. You see, I fear in our generation that because the bar has been set so miserably low within the church generally, that we all pat ourselves on the back and think what great Christians we are because we're not caught up in Toronto, or what great Christians we are because we understand the Word of God. But as I take the standard of Peter, and I set the qualities that I have just mentioned to you alongside my life, and I ask myself the question, are these things found in me in light of the treasure that has come to indwell this vessel? In light of the exceeding great and precious promises that are mine in Christ, that I might be a partaker of his divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust? Are these things abounding in my life? And if not, why not? And the only conclusion that I have to come to if they're not is that I'm settled on my lee. I'm at ease. There's no challenge around me. The average Christian is living a life so below that which they should. And so we pat ourselves on the back and we say, well, praise God, I come to a church that preaches the word and I haven't beaten anyone up this week and I'm not getting drunk, you know, on wine, so I'm doing all right. Peter doesn't hear mention getting drunk on wine. He speaks about temperance, the ability to control my passion when anger rises up within me. He speaks about a devotion to God, fear intermingled with love. He speaks about brotherly kindness. He speaks about love. He speaks about moral excellence, patience. If these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as I close this morning, Peter leaves us here with a warning. But he that lacketh these things, to the one whose life falls short of these qualities not only being in them, but overflowing, Peter says to that one that is blind and cannot see afar off. In other words, the Greek there means that he's short-sighted. What is it to be short-sighted? I can only see things this close. But you see, there's exceeding great and precious promises over there. And I've lost sight of them, you see. And so my Christianity is like, I just live like this. Short-sighted. And Peter is saying that there's need again to get a hold on these promises, friends. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. If we be dead with Christ and risen with him. Wonderful promises that are ours for the taking. Peter says, lift up your eyes and behold these promises again from afar and make them yours in experience. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off. And then he uses another way of saying this. He says, and has forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. He's lost out of mind that Christ has purged him from his sins. So we need to bring these things back to remembrance. Wherefore, the rather, instead, brothers and sisters, this morning, give diligence. As I close this morning, make every effort. Let me, my person, this is a personal thing. When I've preached this sermon, I've got to go back home just like you have. And I've got to face trial and temptation just like you. The only difference is that I am under a greater, stricter judgment because I've preached to you. If I do not now make these things my experience as best I can in my life. Friends, I cannot excuse failure as a Christian. If we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. Yes, but Peter calls us up to a life of victory. Rather, brethren, give diligence, make every effort on your part to make your calling and election sure. That's powerful. That's powerful. No man can claim to be a Christian unless he can evidence it with a life that bears witness to that. Jesus tells us that by their fruits you will know them. Yes, speaking of the false prophets. But Paul goes on to say in 2 Corinthians 13 and verse 5, to examine ourselves, to make search and inquiry, to see indeed if Christ be in you, lest you fail the test. And one way that we can make our calling of God, our choosing, our election sure, is by evidencing these qualities in abundance in our life that would commend our lives to God, because we didn't produce it. He did it in us. And that life is being worked out of us. As Paul says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling in Philippians 2. Does not mean work it out, get a calculator and compute it. It means to work it out, to live it out. To allow that life to be worked out in experience, the treasure store that's within. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, let us run this race. Let this entrance be opened to us. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them and be established in the present truth. Amen. And so I leave these words with you this morning, and as I said, I preach this Thursday, and The Lord seemed to have preached it again to me in my sleep. I mean, the verses, I just dreamt 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 to 12. It was like God was preaching to me, and I just woke up with such an even greater intensity. Lord, I want these things overflowing in my own life. And so God's not beating us up this morning. We've took the mirror of his word and we've reflected it. And it's a call to come up to higher ground. And so, Father, I thank you this morning for your gracious hand of mercy in speaking to us this timely message this morning. Oh, how often, Father, we can be settled on our knees, at ease in Zion, resting and thanking God that we're not like other men are, tax collectors and publicans and sinners. Oh, but Lord, as we've taken the standard of thy word this morning, as we've looked at these qualities that Peter tells us by virtue of the new life that is ours and the divine power of God at work in our lives, giving to us these exceeding precious promises, that, Lord, these things should be overflowing in abundance within us. And perhaps this morning, Father, that some of us have become blind, short-sighted. We've lost sight, Lord, of the promises. We've lost sight, Lord, of the great work of the Holy Ghost that you have wrought in us, such that if any man be in Christ, is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things are become new. Oh, that we could recover our sight this morning, and that we could aim for higher ground. That we could recall to mind this morning the crucified Savior, nailed to the cross to purge us from our sins. Shall we take that precious blood now and trample it underfoot? God forbid. Father, we pray this morning, Lord, that these qualities could be ours, that we would be diligent to make them ours, Lord, and to wipe away all excuse. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.